Messenger organizers for letting me come here and give a talk, and the Queer Institute as well. I was a bit concerned when I sent my title and abstract to Folke that my abstract is too short, but apparently my title was too long and it got truncated when it was put on schedule. It was called just Geometry in Sage, and oh, here we are. It's Geometry Directory in Sage. And one of the, not necessarily complaints, I guess, but just comments that I heard from people is that you go there and there is a lot of modules for seemingly the same thing, so which one do you pick? And so we have here lattice polytop, we have polyhedra, we have polytop, and then there is also polyhedron folder on the top. So there is a lot of stuff with the same name. Well, right, similar. So let me go back to some very long time ago. According to the copyright notice in the file, it's 2006. When William Steiner wrote module polytop.p, which was some basic interface to Polymaker. I'm not really sure how did it work. I did not bother to look, and I don't think that anyone else should have any inclinations to do so. It somehow worked back then, but there was no question about including Polymaker as a standard package for Sage. Because it was very big, about half the size of the whole Sage distribution at that time, it took a very long time to compile, also about half of the time of the whole Sage. And that half and half was something like maybe 30 megabytes, 30 minutes, compared to 60 megabytes for Sage and an hour of compilation on a single core of old style CPUs. Sage was small. And then, sometime in the fall of 2006, I wrote module lattice-polytop.p, which was included into Sage in 2007, I think, in January. My original goal was just to be able to use PULP in a user-friendly way. Those of you who know PULP probably know how it works. It's a set of command line utilities where you need to specify some flags when you start the command, then your input data for the polytop, you get the output, and then you need to start again. If you want to automatically process a lot of polytops, that's fine. If you want to play with a single one, it's not necessarily the most convenient way. The fact that the goal was to use PULP conveniently is reflected in the deep structure of the code, which is not necessarily a good thing, but that's just how it happened. PULP was included as a standard package right away because it's small, it's less than a megabyte, and I know maybe the actual archive of the source code is like 100 kilobytes. It also builds in a few minutes, maybe 1 second in modern computers. The interface was done using files and system calls. So the module creates a file, which is then sent to PULP, and then the output of file is read and processed back in Sage. So let's take a look at how it works. Let's construct a simplex. And unlike previous speakers, I think that one of the great features of the notebook interface is to be able to typeset your mathematics. So I'll use LaTeX representation for objects. In particular, this is simplex delta with three vertices conveniently. Two means that it is two-dimensional, and zero that has an index zero in an internal database. The simplex is reflexive polytop, and Sage recognizes that it is reflexive, it's two-dimensional, so it actually has it inside. As we can see, it took some time. You may have even noticed some delay just with your eyes, and the actual measurement tells that we have spent 3/10 of a second, which is quite a bit. for simple polytop, part of it is due to loading of this internal database. If we do it again, we are down to 0.07 of a second, which is a little bit better. But if you want to process thousands of polytops, then a thousand of simplices like that seems to be simple, but it would take, I guess, 70 seconds just to construct them, which is the main drawback of this module, probably. So here is what you can do in terms of interacting with pulp directly. You can call one of the routines in pulp with given flags, and it will give you the output of the string. Here we are calling poly.x with fp to compute points of our simplex. We can ask for points instead directly, in which case we will get a matrix of integers with columns being points of this polytop. One advantage to calling points directly is not only getting it in something which is easier to manipulate in Sage, but also the results are cached, so at least you are not hit with this system call overhead again and again. And particular interest to me was working with NF partitions. So here I believe I reproduced the flags necessary to compute NF partitions for this simplex. And again, if you use a special command, it's more human-friendly output. And you have a lot of methods that did not exist in pulp. We can also plot 2 and 3D reflexive polytops, but since two-dimensional ones are usually easier, I never bothered to write a code that plots them. And instead, there is a code that plots three-dimensional polytops, and a quick code that just puts your two-dimensional polytop into three dimensions and then plots it as a 3D image, which is not ideal, but may work if you really want to look at them. Let's also take a look at the whole of this simplex, which is also a simplex, but it has all sides increased by 3, so it has two internal integral points on each edge. Then, also a long time ago, I think about a year after I have written the lattice polytop, Marshall Hampton wrote polyhedra.p module, which was maybe file-based or maybe not interface to CDD, which is a double description library, which is also a standard package in Sage. And it allows you to work with generic polyhedra, which are not necessarily lattice polytops. They don't have to have integral coordinates, they actually don't have to have rational coordinates. It has some support for working with numerical polytops, although it's not great as I put on the generic ones. You can also have unbounded polytops and so on. Then some time has passed, maybe another year, and Volker has rewritten that module quite a bit, and that rewrite is now gone as well. So things were changing. Then a few years ago, we have added a collection of modules for working with toric geometry, and one of the basic building blocks is a cone. A cone is a polyhedron, but the implementation in Sage is completely standalone. So cone for toric varieties is a special class with special methods. On the one hand, to just reduce the number of methods which are relevant. For example, you don't really care about vertices of the cone in toric geometry, because you always know that there is a single vertex, the origin. On the other hand, Lattice polytops did not allow working with unbounded polytops, so you could not base columns on them, and existing polyhedra at the time were not particularly fast. And in toric geometry, you want to work with a lot of columns that form of n, so if it's slow, even on simple examples, it's not going to work on something interesting. In the beginning, some of the operations that wanted to exploit polyhedral nature of these columns, we are going back to pulp, and you can work with a cone as large as polytop if you will just truncate it at the appropriate level, which I believe is exactly what we've done. But then Polk included a Palmer polyhedral library into Sage and made a cone class use it, which drastically improved speed. As an example, we have seen that there is a library of toric varieties, and doc tests for that module used to pass in 200 seconds or so. Currently, they pass in 15 seconds, I think. And I think that the main speedup was exactly due to switch to PPL instead of PAL. So let's try to use this geometry which is aimed at toric varieties. If you start reading any book on toric varieties or most of the papers, they start by saying that let's take lattice N and its dual M, or perhaps in the opposite order, let's take lattice M and its dual N. And, it's duality, so of course if you take M dual, you better get N back. N and M are so common names that that's what Sage does by default. If you really want, you can rename your toric lattices to anything. We can plot this lattice, so that's how it looks in two dimensions. Set of dots going in horizontal and vertical direction. We can also construct some cones in this lattice. To construct a cone, you need to give rays. I guess that was perhaps another reason for introducing a special class. When you construct a polyhedra and you happen to have rational inequalities for its facets, or maybe rational ray generators, or maybe integral but non-primitive, there is no real reason why we want to change it. For toric geometry, almost always you want to work with primitive integral generators, and if we try to give something else as an input in the same directions, it should work, and the rays will be scaled appropriately, converted to integral vectors, and so on. Now let's take a look at how does this cone look like. So here it is. It's the first ladder. Let's now construct two more cones and assemble three of them into a pen. Pen has a very similar interface to cones. In particular, you can look at its rays, and you can look at all the cones which are included there. What we have provided was three cones that generate the fan, but a fan is a collection of cones with the condition that a face of each cone is also a part of the fan. Here's a nice diagram of all these cones, which you probably never want to really look at it graphically, but there are methods that allow you to work this lattice if you want to look at adjacents, so at upper faces and subfaces of any cone inside. We can also plot it, and as we probably know, this is a standard fan for the projective plane. If we plot it in a slightly different way, we'll see that we have triggered some deprecation of warning inside of the cone, and we also can see that this is our simplex back, which comes from the fact that the simplex is prefers a polytope, and for reflexive polytopes you can think about associated fans as either normal fans on one side or a phase fan on the other. That is a fan which is spanned by whose columns are generated by phases of your polytope. You can construct a phase fan of our simplex directly without constructing each of the columns first, and we see that it is not equal to sigma. This equality is just a little bit less strict than is. So is requires that you have two references to the same object. Equality means that you have different objects in memory, but just as abstract data sets, they are the same. In particular, say for producing these plots and for giving rays and so on, you need to have some order so that it's clear what is U1, U2, and so on. And equality does take into account this order, which is good in the sense that it's very quick. It's possible to quickly compare it to columns or fans. But it may not be what you want mathematically. So if you use the method is equivalent, then all this extra imposed order will be discarded, and it will check that as a collection of columns, which are columns on a collection of rays as the same. And finally, you may also want to check whether two fans are isomorphic or not, which would mean that one can be mapped into another by integral change of coordinates. Of course, if your fans are equal, they will be equivalent. If they are equivalent, they will be isomorphic. And if they are not isomorphic, they are different, and the parameters will be different. Yes.
Does it give the map if they are equivalent?
I think you can get to it. Yeah, so isomorphism. I believe it is fine. Okay, surprisingly one time to compute the identity matrix, but it works. So maybe it had to, probably it had to load somewhere.
It has a start of mid-cap. There's some group theory.
Yeah. So what it does, it computes automorphism group of a certain graph with some labels that, so I guess you take a graph with vertices corresponding to rays and edges corresponding to 2D columns, with appropriate labels, and then you make sure that you do not you make sure that the isomorphism of graphs actually lifts to a linear. And then we can also check that it is equivalent to the normal fan of the power of our simplex. Let me also construct for future use a fan morphism which is given by double the identity matrix from two-dimensional fan to two-dimensional fan, but the first fan will be generated by a single column, by the first quadrant. The second one is our projective plane. Let's also play a little bit more with plots. You have already seen plots of some of the 3D fans in focus talks. And here is another one. It looks a little bit busy with all the text labels sigmas. But if you follow Cloud mailing list, then you may have seen that in the near future, hopefully, Cloud Sagebus will support MassJax for labels in 3D plots. And then hopefully these pictures will look pretty. sphere or a circle spans or constructs its two-dimensional pole knot on the generators, not going beyond the vertices. You can see all the options in the toric quarter. For example, if you are using SageTech to include pictures of our fans into your paper, you probably want to adjust the font size of labels to 10 or 12 to match the font size of your document. A bunch of options are set by default to none, which means that they will be somehow automatically chosen based on other options or on the data of the actual fans that you have provided. And the method toric quarter options, I hope, has quite clear documentation. It certainly is clear to me, but as I have written it, maybe my opinion is a bit biased. Let's try, for example, to adjust all alpha to 1. And what do you get when you... what do you get when you use the toric quarter options is that you do not need to pass the same options to each toric object that you construct. So all your pools will be uniform. And here you can see that probably wall alpha 1 is a better choice. I find these colors extremely poisonous and unattractive. So let's reset options for future use to default. Now there are a few exciting, rather not few, but a lot, exciting additions by Paul Brown in the last couple of years. He completely rewritten a polyhedra module, which is now gone and replaced by a separate folder in the geometry directory. Part of the rewrite was to allow different backends for polyhedra, and currently you have a choice between PPL, which works great, but only for exact fields, for rational polytopes, and CDDLib is there for backward compatibility and for working with numerical polytopes. Both are library interfaces, so there are no overheads associated with files and system calls. He also written a quote for computing and trading through triangulations, which can optionally use TOPCOM for certain operations, and you do not need to install TOPCOM yourself. It's an optional package which builds quite reliably from my personal experience. There is a quote to compute integral points in polytops, again without any kind of extra overhead, which is important when you're working with small polytops, such as pretty much all reflexive polytops that tend to have, in five dimensions, they're still under 1,000 points each. And there is also a new class for lattice polytops, which uses PPL as a backend as well. And it does not have too many features compared to a lattice polytop, but it is much faster and allows you, for example, to do something with all four-dimensional reflexive polytops, and there is about 500 million of them. Any previous modules that were there just do not cut it. They're way too slow to construct the objects, not even trying to do anything with them. And unfortunately, in this recent years, I was not as active in toric geometry as I would like to, perhaps, and as Olga probably would like me to be. So if there are some more people who want to work in toric geometry and not necessarily even contribute code, but to review focus code, it would be great. As we all know, you cannot do anything by yourself on Sage. You need to have at least one more person to review whatever you are doing. And some things to be done in the future. My hope is to do a at least some of it this week in the remaining couple of days, is to clean up what is polytop code, which is currently convoluted inside and relies on knowing what other functions are doing when you're in the code of all. Another one reason is just to make it more readable for other people. Another is to try to allow easily adjusting backends and in particular using PPL whenever possible. I believe that the only thing that PAL does that PPL cannot do is computing net partitions. And well, maybe also computing watch numbers, but if you can count points and construct phase vertices, you can compute watch numbers yourself quite easily. And another thing, it would be nice to have two-dimensional plotting as well for demonstrations and papers. And actually, let me show you one of the things that I would like to be able to do. So, for example, here is a picture of net partitions. We see again our simplex in red on this side and big simplex in red on the other side. What is a net partition for those who don't know it in terms of polytops? It's a decomposition in the M lattice of a big reflexive polytop, red one, into Minkowski sum of two smaller lattice polytops, which are not reflexive anymore. It's the green one and the blue one. It's such a decomposition into Minkowski sum that if you take the convex half of all the small polytops, the yellow one, you will also get a reflexive polytop. Having two reflexive polytops on that side allows you to get two reflexive polytops in the N lattice as well. Then you can also hook up two smaller polytops such that two polytops here will be also convex half and Minkowski sum of the small ones. So this gives you duality of net partitions and that leads to mirror symmetry of mirror symmetric pairs of families of Calabi-Yau's realized as complete intersections of net devices in peripheralities. The plots look close to the plots of cones and fans that we have seen because I just took the code and customized it to produce these pictures. But of course it would be nice to have it automatically. Okay, let's now switch to toric geometry in the sense of toric varieties. And let's construct projective space from the fan that we have already prepared. So here's a toric variety constructed without any kinds of libraries or high-level operations, completely from scratch, from rays, columns, and fans. If we plot it, we'll see the picture of the fan, but now each ray has a label which corresponds not just some abstract name for the ray, which only appears on the plot, but rather it has an associated homogeneous variable. So the coordinate ring here is a polynomial ring in Z0, Z1, Z2. By default, if you do not specify the field, then the varieties will have coordinate ring with rational numbers as the base field. Internally, we, or at least I always thought about complex numbers and complex varieties. It's just not particularly convenient to work with polynomials over C because of the way how coefficients are represented, because it's not exact. There may be some methods that may give you not quite what you expect if you really think about rational numbers. I think that in such cases there is always at least a check for characteristic. So if you try to use a finite field request some operation that assumes that it is seen internally, you should get an error message. It is also possible that you will try to do something and there are no assumptions in the code, but it will just crash because we have never tried to do it with finite fields, and when a person tried to work with the operators over finite fields, she quickly found a number of bugs. So if something tells you that it's not implemented for certain fields, well, feel free to implement it. If it just fails for some other reason, obviously it's a bug, and we'll be happy to try to fix it. We have already seen that you cannot construct subschemes of P2 given by improper polynomials, by non-homogeneous ones, and in general it will do appropriate homogeneous check for whatever toric variety you're working with. I actually tried to construct also a subscheme generated by the 0, the 1, and the 2. And it is possible, you can work with it. For example, check that it is smooth. I got a little bit concerned that there is no check for it being in the relevant ideal, but it is actually fine, I think, since it seems to recognize that it's an empty scheme of dimension less than 0. Okay, let me now construct also and affine plane as a toric variety and use the previously constructed fine morphism to construct now a scheme morphism between affine toric variety and projected toric variety. The default description does not give you too much information, but if you look at it as a polynomial map, then you can see what it does on coordinates. And you can also look at the factorization of this map. So what we do here, we first take the square, then we embed an affine plane into projective variety with the flip of coordinates, and the last map seems to be just the identity. What we get here in general is first a subjective map from our domain to the image. Second, a dominant map or rational morphism from the image to the closure of the image inside of the codomain. And then finally, injective morphism embedding of the closure of the image into the domain. The motivation for this factorization came from the second project on the left. For vibration of toric varieties, it's natural to work either with subjective morphism or at most with composition of a subjective and a dominant morphism. Because in this case, over each point of a fixed torus orbit of the codomain, you will have exactly the same structure for each of the fibers. And then you can ask for a fiber by specifying a cone corresponding to this fixed torus orbit of the codomain. So let's step away from the typeset mode for a second and try to print our projective plane. It is a two-dimensional toric variety, as expected, covered by three affine patches. The affine patches which are counted here correspond to largest natural affine patches of the toric variety associated to generating codes, and we have three of them. We can construct the same projective plane by using CPR-FANO toric variety, and CPR-FANO stands for Crepantly Partially Resolved FANO. If you work with reflexive polytops, then the fan generated by either toric variety corresponding to either phase fan or normal fan will be Gorenstein FANO. And if you subdivide this fan using only generators corresponding to integral points on the boundary of the reflexive polytope, then you will get Krepenta resolution on each step, and you may try to resolve it completely. It may not always be possible in dimensions higher than 3. So in general, you get Krepenta partial resolution. And in physics, what is commonly used is MPCP resolution, maximal projective Krepenta partial resolution. Maximal stands for using all points available to you. Projective means that the triangulation that you pick to do your subdivision will give you a projective toric, so it's convex. It's a condition which is a bit harder to check, so we probably can check it using focus triangulation fold. But by default, you can construct non-projective resolutions as well. And if we try to plot this variety, it will be almost exactly the same. The only difference is that before we had Z1 on the left and Z0 on the top. Now they're switched. And the switch is due to the order of vertices of our singlets that we have provided to the constructor. This constructor tries to keep as consistent the numeration of lattice points, variables, and traces of the fan as possible. Because otherwise, some people like me got easily confused. Another great advantage of constructing this CP alpha toric varieties is that you get access to anticanonical hypersurface constructors as well as complete intersection ones. Let's take a look at the anticanonical hypersurface in P2. It is an elliptic curve given by this cubic. The coefficients are generic coefficients, so A0, A1, A6, and A2. And again, the way how these coefficients are enumerated by default is to match the enumeration of points on the follow of the simplex. The sixth point is the origin in this case, and the product of all variables always corresponds to the origin in this equation. A little caveat is that the ambient space of this anticanonical hypersurface is not the projective space from which we have started. The reason is that we have introduced this coefficient. So the base field was automatically extended to include all necessary coefficients. In the projective space, we also can consider not just cubic given by cubes of variables and the product of all of them. And one way to get a completely generic cubic is to specify that you want to get or to use all monomial points, in which case all points of the polar simplices will correspond to monomials and appropriate coefficients here. Okay, let's also play a little bit with the follow of the projective plane, so we have used a small triangle to construct the base plan on it, and the big triangle for constructing the anticanonical hypersurface. If we switch the rows and go to the mirror elliptic curve, we can also try to do this Krepenta partial resolution, in this case maximal, and use all coordinate points to get the following fan. I have also tried to play a bit with coordinate parameters. In this case, even if you try to get all monomial points, you will only get a cube of original three variables and their product. And in this case, monomials have more coordinates because of the subdivision. Each new ray is adding a new homogeneous coordinate. You can play with devices in Turkic varieties as well, and divisor here is divisor is a variety, it's not a class. In particular, it, the ambient space where it lives supports only torus invariant divisors. You can take arbitrary combination, but they all come from monomials. You can do checks on it, for example, that it is not a Katia divisor, but all of them will be Q-Veil divisors. You can take a look at its homology class or on its polyhedron. And it's an ample divisor, so its polyhedron is actually the simplest that we have started with, or close to it, because of the one half that I speak in the beginning. This vertex is actually at one half, and all others are there as well. We can also compute a lot of things, such as, for example, Stanley Riesner ideal. And it's a thing which is related to the relevant ideal, which you can try to compute if you factor each of the generators of the Stanley Riesner ideal and then take the product. So here is how we can obtain the relevant ideal for the projective plane. Let's also do it for the product of P1s. And combinatorially, these ideals correspond to so-called primitive collections, which are the largest which are sets of rays such that they do not belong to any column, but if you throw away any element of this collection, then you will get a set of array which do belong to some of the columns. My original goal when I was writing this worksheet was to take a look at the Stanley Riesner ideal for the polar of the projective plane, and now the resolution it gets a little bit long. Then I tried to compute the relevant ideal, and I quickly used all my 4 gigabytes of RAM and started using swap, so I had to kill it. So irrelevant ideals are not computationally convenient tool for toric varieties. It's a simple two-dimensional variety with just 9 rays, and you already cannot really operate with it. So it's better to rephrase the questions that relate to this relevant ideal in terms of primitive collections and Stanley Riesner ideal. And I believe that that's all that I wanted to tell you, so if there are any questions or requests to try to do something else, I'll try.
You know, you want to put one of these images in your paper, and then you want, because it's being actually published, you want it to be some sort of vector image or some sort of very high resolution image. I remember that Volker was working on some routines to do that a while ago. Are they in stage now? And are, if so, are they in stage for three-dimensional images or only for the two-dimensional ones?
I haven't actually worked on that. It's one of the things that I also really want. Three-dimensional vector graphics.
Mm.
That is a three-dimensional, like the projection of C to two dimension. The projection from C to two dimension drawn as vector graphics. There's some special PDF feature where you can embed three-dimensional objects, but then no preview as supports that. So it's, and there is of course bitmap rastering, which is a bit ugly. Yeah, but that's the current state. So we don't have anything for that. Well, of course, the 2D graphics for fans that you can easily get as 3D.
Alright. So 2D is good, 3D is work in progress?
Yeah. But for 2D, you just do the usual, you save as PDF and then do your PDF.
And if you use SageTF, it will be wiped automatically. It is also possible to, if we go back somewhere to 3D picture. So we can use viewer tachyon. Which will look, oh, you may still see some shadows of colors, but it's definitely not what you wanted. And with tachyon, you have to adjust, for example, alpha settings differently, thickness differently, it does not support text labels, and it's still a raster image, but you can increase the resolution, so you can make it suitable for printing perhaps. But it's very cumbersome use, in my opinion. And if we do not try to interact with the port, then whatever is currently produced by CH, it is actually a raster 2D port generated by JMOL. And you can pass rotation parameters to it and in principle increase the resolution. But there is no support in Sage for it directly, and I try to just rip the code that produces this picture and adjust it to something that will save these pictures rendered by JMOL with high resolution, but I did not have much success. So it's still seems to misinterpret some settings, and when you try to get something really nice, say 600 DPIs, then it just crashes. So existing things is not the way to go.
Well, actually, you might have seen a preview of William's implementation of a viewer in.
That doesn't give you EDF output, it gives you WebGL. So it's localized in your browser.
Okay, in your browser, but I guess...
You can take a screenshot if you want, but that won't give you the two, that won't give you a publication.
So does it support the SVG generation of 3D ports?
Mm.
I think it's default for 2D ports now.
No, I mean...